Let us continue with the last part before jumping into the next chapter. On your atlas, your anatomy atlas, take a look at the figures related deep dissection of superior mediastinum. Also, the figure of dissection of mediastinum right side and left side, especially, right? The parallel structures of the trachea, esophagus, less recurrent laryngeal nerve, the thoracic duct. Take a look at the right bronchus. It's shorter, a little bit more vertical, and wider than the left bronchus. The course of the right bronchial artery is abnormal because usually it passes posterior to the bronchus. Right. On to the figures on the right mediastinum side and the left side. Take a look, denominated the arch of the aorta, the thoracic aorta, the common carotid to the left side and subclavian arteries. And also take a look at the sympathetic trunk attached to the intercostal nerves communicating its branches. Right, by the right side, usually the most of the part of the costal and mediastina pleura, and this kind of dissection is removed to expose the underlying structures, and that way you can take a look this side of mediastinum, right, which is denominated by the arch of the ascicus vein. You can take a look at the superior vena cava at the right atrium. Take a look at the anterior view of esophagus, trachea, bronchi, and aorta. Take a look in your atlas, the branches of the thoracic aorta. Right, and also take a look at the thoracic duct and bronchomediastinal trunks, right, and which is also very interesting, right, and where you can take a look of how they are arranged, right. Take a look the ascicular systems of veins, the autonomic nerves or the superior and posterior mediastinum, right? You will be able to look the middle cervical ganglions, right? The T2 sympathetic ganglions. You will be able to see the cardiac plexus, the aorta, the esophagus, the TA sympathetic ganglions, the splenic nerves, and in between esophageal nerve plexus, right? And all that, it can be visualized and that way you review the names, review all the anatomies, right? Which we were have explained. And we're gonna be jumping into abdomen, right? And the like I was telling you, everything that starts has an end. And we had already covered everything that is basically most important for this training of medicine doctor, right? And everything related with thorax is already covered. We started everything from the beginning. Today, right now, we have ended the dead thorax, and we are jumping into abdomen, right? And when we're going to be talking about abdominal cavity, anterolateral abdominal walls, peritoneum and peritoneal cavity, and abdominal viscera, thoracic diaphragm, posterior abdominal wall, and we're going to take a look at some of the things that there are in the book, which are very interesting, right? The abdomen is part of the trunk between the thorax and pelvis. And it contains musculotendinous walls, except posteriorly, where the wall includes the lumbar vertebrae and intervertebral disc, four discs, right? And encloses the abdominal cavity with peritoneal cavity, abdominal viscera, soft burst, and the internal organs. And we know them as stomach, intestines, liver, blood vessels, lymphatic, nerves, right, and glands, which are into the internal organs. The abdominal cavity forms, right, superiorly a major part of the abdominal pelvic cavity, and it stays between the thoracic diaphragm, and some people call it a lies between, right, and also the superior pelvic aperture, right, and some other people will call them inlet. The diaphragm is the roof of the abdomen, right, and some people will call it abdominal cavity. It has no floor of its own. It's continuous with pelvic cavity. This abdominal cavity will extend above into osteocartilaginous thoracic cage. And also, some people will call them rib cage from the fourth intercostal space. And where some organs from the abdomen, the spleen, the liver, kidneys, part of kidneys, stomach, part of the kidneys, right, will be protected by thoracic cage. Extended part of the pelvis, superior to the pelvic inlet, which is the greater pelvis, will provide support, and partly will protect the lower abdominal viscera. And it says that it's going to be taken just portion of ilium secum sigmoid colon. This cavity, which is the abdominal, the one that we're talking about, contains peritoneum, a serous membrane lining, abdominal pelvic cavity, and which will cover some of the and most of the organs. Some fat, right? Digestive organs, stomach, intestine, liver, gland, bladder, pancreas, some portion of your genital system, kidneys or uterus, and spleen. Therefore, the abdominal cavity is a major part of the abdominal pelvic cavity, and it will be found between the diaphragm and the pelvic inlet. It will be separate from the thoracic cavity by the diaphragm and continues inferiorly with pelvic cavity and cover of the thoracic cage and superiorly. It support partially and protects inferiorly by the greater pelvis. The space surrounded by the multi-layered abdominal walls and located of most digestive organs. And location of most digestive organs, spleen, kidneys, and most of the ureters, right? Take a look at your atlas at this level, the abdominal pelvic cavity, right? We will see, right, it will be 9 regions of the abdominal cavity, right? And the 9 regions will be delineated by 4 planes. 2 horizontal subcostal and transtubercular planes, 2 vertical midclavicular planes, right? 4 quadrants of the abdominal cavity are going to be defined by 2 planes, right? Take a look at the figures, right, that your book is showing you. 1 horizontal transumbilical plane, 1 vertical medial plane, and to describe the horizontal planes will be subcostal plane, which is going to be through the inferior border of the 10th costal cartilage on each side. The transtubercular plane, which is through the iliac tubercles and the body of the L5 vertebrae, 5 centimeters posterior to the anterior superior iliac spines. A transumbilical plane through the umbilicus and 4 discs between L3 and L4 vertebrae. And the vertical planes will be midclavicular planes through the midpoint of the clavicles, 9 centimeters from the midline to the mid inguinal points, midpoints of the lines, which are putting together the anterior superior iliac spines and the superior edge of the pubic symphysis, the medial plane through the body dividing into right and left halves. Take a look at your book, right? The abdominal regions and the quadrants, right? The abdominal regions are going to be the RH, the right hypochondriac, the RL, the right lumbar, the RE, the right inguinal, the LH, the left hypochondriac, the LL, the left lumbar, the LI, left inguinal, the RUQ, right upper quadrant, the LUQ, the left upper quadrant, the RLQ, the right lower quadrant, the LLQ, the left lower quadrant. The abdominal quadrants are going to be medial plane, transumbilical plane, anterior superior iliac spine inguinal ligament. The abdominal reference planes are going to be the midclavicular plane, subcostal plane, the iliac crest, transtubercular plane, the iliac tubercle, the anterior superior iliac spine, and the pubic symphysis. Take a look at your tables, the locations of abdominal structures and quadrants. Anterolateral abdominal wall. Even though the abdominal wall is continuous, subdivides in anterior wall, right and left lateral walls, and posterior walls, anterior lateral abdominal wall will be found from the thoracic cage to the pelvis. Where most of the part of this wall is musculotendinous. And its boundaries between the anterior and lateral wall, it will be indefinite. And therefore, the combined term anterolateral abdominal wall is used because some structures, as the muscles and cutaneous nerves, are found in both anterior and lateral walls. When the doctor promotes or goes into the physical examination, the anterolateral wall is inspected, palpated, percussed, and auscultated. And where the surgeons incise this wall during abdominal surgery. And therefore it's called the anterolateral abdominal wall, right? Superiorly by the cartilage of 7th through 10th ribs and hyphoid process of the sternum breast bone. Inferiorly by the inguinal ligament and pelvic bone. The wall consists of skin and subcutaneous tissue. And is made mostly of fat, muscles, deep fascia, and to abdominal fascia fat and parietal peritoneum. Right? And where the skin will attach loose to the subcutaneous tissue, excepting at the umbilical, where is firmly adhere. And the anterolateral wall consists of three musculotendinous layers, which has fibers running in different directions, three ply structures similar at the same, like the intercostal spaces in the thorax. The fascia of the anterolateral abdominal wall. This tissue, which is subcutaneous, is over most of the wall, consists of a layer of connective tissue containing different amounts of fat. When the person, the student takes a look at the cadaver, the fat will be thicker than a normal person, right? And the cadaver is going to be forming sagging folds, which is not usually presented in the body, which is alive. In the inferior parts of the wall, the subcutaneous tissue is compared of two layers. It will have a fatty layer, and it will have a membranous, which is a deeper layer, right? the layer of deep fascia, right? Is it moves to the external oblique and cannot be separated easily from this muscle. The deep fascia and abdomen is not very thick, right? It's very, very thin. And it's represented by epimysiums. And these are sheets, fibrous sheets, which is one of on the most superficial muscles, which makes it relative firm. The membranous sheets in the transversalis fascia is usually in the most of the abdominal wall. The fascia layer will be found covering deep surfaces of transverse abdominal muscle. And it's aponeurosis. And it will be continue right with the deeply to the linea alba. The parietal peritoneum is internal to transversalis fascia, separated by variable amounts of abdominal extraperitoneal fat. The muscles of the anterolateral abdominal wall. There are five muscles in the anterolateral abdominal wall. It will be the external oblique, superficial muscle arising from the middle of the lower rib, which are muscular slips interdigitating with those of the serratus anterior, a pectoral muscle. The fibers of the external oblique pass inferior medially. The internal oblique, intermediate muscle, and where fibers run horizontally at the level of the anterior superior iliac spine. Fibers will run obliquely upward superior to this level and obliquely downward inferior to it. The transverse abdominal, the innermost muscle, the fibers, except for the most inferior ones, will run some sort of transversal medially. It says over here that the three flat muscles anteriorly is a strong sheet-like aponeurosis, right? The aponeurosis of these muscles will be interlacing at the linea alba. The fellows on the opposite side will form a tough aponeurotic tendinal sheets with the rectus muscle. And then the rectus sheet, right, is called. The other ones is vertical muscles, anterolateral abdominal wall, which are within the rectus sheet, will be the rectus abdominis and pyramidalis. Some other parts of the rectus sheet will be superior and inferior epigastric arteries and veins, lymphatic vessels, and ventral primary rami of T7 through T12 nerves. The pyramidalis is a small triangular muscle absent approximately 20% of people. It lies anteriorly, inferiorly, of the rectus abdominis attaches it to anterior surface of pubis, anterior pubis ligament. Ends in the linea alba. Fibrous band running at variable distances, and it will be superior to the pubic symphysis. External oblique muscle. The largest and most superficial of three flat anterolateral abdominal muscles. Muscular part contributes to anterolateral part of abdominal wall, and its aponeurosis contributes to the anterior part. Fibers of external oblique wound inferomedially, the same direction as the fingers do when the hand are in one side pocket. Attachment nerve supply, main actions of this external oblique are presented in how we see at the tables, right? That we can find in our books, right? These muscle fibers will pass inferomedially and turning aponeurotic approximately at the midclavicular line. Form a sheet of tendinous fibers and at the linea alba, medial to pubic tubercle, external oblique aponeurosis attaches to the pubic crest. Inferiorly, margin of external oblique aponeurosis thickens and falls back on itself, and this becomes the inguinal ligament. Fibrous band, which is going to be found between the anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic tubercle. The inguinal ligament, therefore, not a freestanding structure. And folding back on itself becomes curved to form through, forms the floor of the inguinal canal, and where some fibers of the inguinal ligament pass upwards to cross the linea alba and blend with the lower fibers contralaterally upon with aponeurosis contralateral. And all these fibers form the reflected inguinal ligament. The internal oblique muscle the intermediate of three flat abdominal muscles, the internal oblique, which is a very thin sheet, muscular sheet, fans out anteromedially, right? And contains fibers becoming aponeurosis and roughly same midclavicular line at the external oblique, and takes participation in the formation of a rectus sheet. Inferior aponeurotic fibers of internal oblique arch over the spermatic cord, and it will pass through the inguinal canal. Fibers descending posteriorly to the superficial inguinal ring will attach to the pubic crest and pectin pubis. A sharp ridge which continues of the superior pubic ramus. Most inferior medial tendinous fibers of internal oblique will be with aponeurotic fibers of the deeply placed transverse abdominal muscle, and it will be conjoint tendon. Turning inferiorly and attaching at the pubic crest and pectin pubis. The attachments of nerve supplies, main actions of the internal oblique, we can see it also, right? take a look at your tables at this level, right, in your atlas as well, in your books, and what we are describing and what is there, right? And then we say that and into the internal oblique and transverse abdominal, there is a narrow vascular plane corresponding a similar plane of the intercostal spaces. It says over here that in these planes lies between the middle and deepest layers of muscles, the neurovascular plane of the anterolateral abdominal wall, which will contain the thoracoabdominal nerve, and this can be found anterior abdominal cutaneous branches of ventral primary rami intercostal nerve at T7 through T11. Subcostal nerve, enlarged ventral ramus at T12 nerve, iliohypogastric and ilioinguinal nerve, branch of ventral ramus at L1 nerve, inferior intercostal, subcostal, and lumbar arteries, and deep circumflex iliac artery, which is a branch of external iliac artery. At this level, anteriorly, nerves and vessels will leave the planes, the neurovascular planes, and where they will be found further in a more superficial plane. The transverse abdominal muscle is fibers of transverse abdominal muscle, right? Innermost of the three flat abdominal muscles will found or wound more transversal medially. in regards of the inferior ones that wound parallel to those of the internal oblique, fibers of transverse abdominal muscle will be ending in a point of rosis, contributing in the formation of the rectus sheath, and attachment nerve supplies and actions, which are the main action of the transverse abdominal muscles, can be found, right? As you will take a look in all the tables related with transverse abdominal muscle, take a look at it, right? Review it, right? To get a little bit more information. The rectus abdominis muscle is one long, broad strip-like muscle in the vertical muscle. It's a principal vertical muscle anterior in the anterior abdominal wall, right? And it will be found attached, right? The nerve supply and main actions, right, are going to be found also, and it's very important to take a look at all these details, right, in the book. Take a look at these details. He said this pair of rectus muscles are separated, right? The rectus abdominis, right? But before that, as we are talking about, they are separated by the linea alba, right? And then we're like closely together inferiorly. The rectus abdominis is three times wide superiorly as inferiorly. And it's broad and thin superiorly, and narrow and thick inferiorly. This rectus abdominis is enclosed in a sheath, and it's called rectus sheath, right? And this rectus muscle anchors transversely attached to the anterior layer of the rectus sheet at three or more tendinous intersections. When the persons are tense, the muscles stretch between the tendinous intersection bulge upward. These intersections are grooves in the skin between, right? Indicates by grooves in the skin between muscular bulges. And in between, they're found in between the level of hyphoid processes, umbilicus, and halfway between these structures. And then the rectus sheets are strong and complete fibrous compartments on the rectus abdominis and pyramidalis muscles. Is formed by the interweaving of aponeurosis of flat abdominal muscles. Above two-thirds of the internal oblique aponeurosis splits into layers. At the lateral border of the rectus abdominis, one lamina passing anteriorly to the muscle and the other passing posteriorly to it. The anterior lamina joins the aponeurosis of the external oblique and forms anterior layer of the rectus sheet. Posterior lamina joins aponeurosis of transverse abdominal muscle, forming posterior layer of rectus sheet. Fibers of anterior and posterior layers of sheets interlace in anterior median line, forming complex linea alba. Take at this level, right? What we already explained in relation with rectus sheet, right? Take a look at the functions and actions of anterolateral abdominal muscles, right? Take a look in your atlas, right? The figures, right, and structures of anterolateral abdominal wall, right, dissected by sections, right, with all these parts that we have already mentioned. The intramuscular exchange, right, of superficial and deep fibers. And take a look at your intermuscular exchange of fibers between aponeurosis of contralateral, external, internal oblique muscles. The nerves of the anterolateral abdominal wall are supplied by thoracoabdominal nerves. The anterior abdominal, which are cutaneous branches of a ventral primary rami of the inferior six thoracic nerves, T7 through T11, subcostal nerves, T12, iliohypogastric and ilioinguinal nerves, right, the thoracoabdominal nerves, they are seen passing anteriorly from the intercostal spaces and running in the neurovascular plane and in between internal oblique and transverse abdominal muscles. supplying to the abdominal skin and muscles. Since the anterior abdominal cutaneous branches pierce the rectum sheet a short distance from the median plane, T7 through T9 supply the skin at the superior level to the umbilicus, then T10, it will innervate the skin around the umbilicus, then T11 plus, right, the cutaneous branches of the subcostal T12, iliohypogastric and ilioinguinal will provide supply to skin at the inferior part to the umbilicus. Take a look in your atlas, the figure, right, where the illustration and how the distribution is accomplished in the thoracoabdominal area, which is the thoracoabdominal nerves. The vessels to the anterolateral abdominal wall, right? It will be superior epigastric from the internal thoracic vessels, inferior epigastric and deep circumflex iliacs from the external iliac vessels, superficial circumflex iliacs and superficial epigastric from the femoral artery and greater saphenous vein. Anterior and collateral branches of the superior, of the posterior intercostal vessels in the 10th and 11th intercostal spaces and from anterior branches of subcostal vessels. Branches of the musculophrenic vessels from the internal thoracic vessel. The arteria supplied to the anterolateral abdominal wall, right? You can take a look, right? And the figures, right? With arteries and lymphatics of the anterolateral abdominal wall. Take a look at it, right? You will find the parasternal lymph nodes, the internal thoracic arteries, the superior epigastric arteries, the axillary lymph node, the superficial inguinal lymph nodes, etc., etc. The superior epigastric artery is directed continuing of the internal thoracic artery, enters the rectus sheet superiorly, and through its posterior layer supplies the upper part for the rectus abdominis, and it will be causing anastomosis with the inferior epigastric artery. The inferior epigastric artery will be coming out from the external iliac artery, and it's just by superior to the inguinal ligament, and it will be found superiorly in the transversalis fascia to get into the rectus sheet below the arcuate line, and in which branches will enter in the bottom part of the rectus abdominis, and it will be causing anastomosis with those of the superior epigastric artery at the umbilical region, right, mostly. And the lymphatic drainage of the anterolateral abdominal wall, it will be found superficial lymphatic vessels in the company of subcutaneous veins. And these are going to be found at the superior part of the umbilicus drain to the axillary lymph nodes and filtrate to the parasternal lymph nodes. And then superficial lymphatic vessels inferior to the umbilicus drain to superficial inguinal lymph nodes. And then it's going to be a deep lymphatic vessels which will be accompanying of the deep veins and drain to the external iliac, which is the common iliac and lumbar, which is the on the flank side, lateral aortic, and lymph nodes, right? Take a look, right, your chart, your table on related arteries and on the anterolateral wall. The interoposterior surface of anterolateral abdominal wall is with parietal peritoneum is covered with it. The infraumbilical part of this surface exhibits several folds, which are called peritoneal folds, and where are remnants of vessels which carry blood to from the fetus, right? The five umbilical peritoneal folds, two on each side and one in the medial plane, pass towards the umbilicals. The medial umbilical fold will be found from the apex of the urinary bladder to the umbilicals and covers the median umbilical ligament and the rest of the uracus, which is called the reduced allantoid stalk, appears joint the apex of the fetal bladder to the umbilicus. This is written, right, in 1998 by some researchers pursued and ruled. The two medial umbilical folds lateral into medial umbilical fold will cover medial umbilical ligaments, right? And the two lateral umbilical folds lateral to medial umbilical folds cover the inferior epigastric vessels. The location of a fossa, peritoneal fossa, is a lateral depression to the umbilical fold, and this shallow fossae between the umbilical folds are supravesical fossae between the median and medial umbilical folds, which are formed as the peritoneum reflects from anterior abdominal wall into the bladder, which are sites for external supravesical hernias. Levels of supravesicular fossae rises and falls with filling and emptying of the bladder. The medial inguinal fossae at the medial and lateral umbilical folds, area commonly called inguinal triangles, are potential sites for less common direct inguinal hernias. Lateral inguinal fossae, lateral to lateral umbilical folds include deep inguinal rings, potential sites for most common type of hernias in lower abdominal wall. Supraumbilical parts of internal surfaces of anterior walls, sagittally oriented peritoneally reflections, are called falciform ligaments. Extending between upper anterior abdominal wall and liver and encloses around ligaments of liver. The round ligaments is a fibrous remnant of umbilical veins extended from the umbilicals to the liver prenatally. The inguinal region is, for some people, called the groin, an important area surgically as a site for inguinal hernias, hernias occurring in both sexes, but usually very common in males. These inguinal are weakness in the inferior part of the contralateral abdominal wall, and it's been known and noticed that it's more weak for males because the spermatic cord passing through the inguinal canal. The inguinal canal in adults is an oblique inferomedially directed passage 4 centimeters long. The inferior part of the anterolateral abdominal wall lies parallel and superior 2 to 4 centimeters to medial half of the inguinal ligament, and which occupies this area is the spermatic cord in males and the round ligament of uterus in females. And functionally and developmentally distinct structures happen to occur in the same location. The inguinal canal contains blood and lymphatic vessels, the ilioinguinal nerve in both sexes. And at each end, the inguinal canal has an opening, the deep inguinal original ring. It is the entrance to the inguinal canal, a site of an outpouching of the transversalis fascia approximately 1.25 centimeters above the middle of the inguinal ligament, and by the side to the inferior epigastric artery. Deep inguinal ring begins with an invagination of the transversalis fascia, which will form an opening in which ductus deferens, a vas deferens is known, a round ligament of uterus in the female, and gonad. Vessels will pass and enter the inguinal canal. The transversalis fascia will continue into canal, forming innermost covering internal fascia traversing the canal. The superficial external inguinal ring will end from the inguinal canal and is a sheet-like opening between the diagonal fibers, and upon necrosis of external oblique superlateral in the pubic tubercle, and where the spermatic cord round ligament in females emerge from inguinal canal. Laterally and medially margins superficially ring formed by split, the aponeurosis, and is called crura. Lateral crus attaches to the pubic tubercle, median crus to the pubic crest. Well, where fibers arise from inguinal ligaments, just besides on the side to the superficial ring arc, superlaterally to superficial ring, the intercrural fibers will provide a help to prevent the crura from spreading apart or from split apart. The inguinal canal have 2 walls, one anterior and another posterior. Some people will call it Well, yeah, anterior and posterior will have also a roof, and it will have a floor. The anterior is by the aponeurosis of the external oblique, with the lateral parotid wall being made by fibers of the internal oblique. The posterior wall by the transversalis fascia, with the medial part of wall reinforced by formation of conjoint tendons, which is called inguinal fats, which come out of the pubic attachments of the internal oblique and transverse abdominal aponeurosis, which forms a common tendon. The roof is formed by the arching fibers of internal oblique and transversal abdominal muscles. The floor will be formed by the superior surface of the incurving inguinal ligament, forming a shallow reinforced most medially by the lacunar ligament, reflecting part of extensions from a deep aspects of the inguinal ligament to peritoneal line of the pectin pubis. The ilopubic tract is called also the deep crural arch. Thickened inferior margin of transversalis fascia appearing a fibrous band which parallel and posterior runs deep to the inguinal ligament. The iliopubic tract is when the inguinal region is seen from its internal aspect, and it makes a contribution to the posterior wall of the inguinal canal, and it bridges the external iliofemoral vessels from the iliopectinal arch to the superior pubis ramus. The development of inguinal canal. The testes develop in the extraperitoneal connective tissues, superiorly lumbar region of the posterior abdominal wall, the cubernaculum, which is a fibrous cord connecting primordial testes to the anterior lateral abdominal wall at the side of the deep ring of the inguinal canal. The peritoneal diverticulum, which is called processus vaginalis, transverse, developing inguinal canal, carrying muscular fascial layers in the anterolateral abdominal wall before entering primordial scrotum. Is talking about the 12 week of development. The testes migrate to the pelvis, and by the 20 weeks, which is more or less by the 7 month of gestation, it goes closer to the developing deep inguinal ring. Take a look at this level. In your atlas and your book, the inguinal canal, spermatic cord, and testes, as well the inguinal ligaments, right? Take a look at the schematic drawings illustrating forms of the inguinal canals and descents of the testes. The drawings and illustrations which forms the inguinal canal in females. Take a look at the schematic coronal section of the inferior part of the anterolateral abdominal wall. And there are a very nice right figure, right, which are showing the arterial supply and lymphatic drainage of the testes and scrotum. Right. It will explain the supply, right, the arterial supply, right, for the scrotum, right, the postperineal branch of internal pudendal arteries, which forms posterior scrotal arteries, the external pudendal branches of femoral arteries that will from the anterior scrotal arteries, the gramastric branch of the inferior epigastric artery. The scrotal veins are usually in company of arteries, and the lymphatic vessels of the scrotum drain into the superficial inguinal lymph nodes. The nerves of the scrotum are the genital branch of the genitofemoral nerve, the L1 through L2, supplying the anterolateral surface of the scrotum, the anterior scrotal nerves, which are ilioinguinal nerve, L1, supplying anterior surface of the scrotum, the posterior scrotal nerves, branches of the perineal branch of the pudendal nerve S2 through S4, supplying the superior surface of the scrotum. Some of the perineal branches of posterior femoral cutaneous nerves S2 through S3 provide supply to the inferior surface of the scrotum. Getting into the epididymis. The epididymis is formed by minute convoluted of duct of the epididymis, tightly compacted, appears solid. They might appear solid. The epididymis lies posterior to the surface of the testes, covered by tunica vaginalis, except at its posterior margin, convoluted duct epididymis becomes progressively smaller, passing from head of the epididymis on the superior part of testis to its tail. Duct deferens or deferens duct begins at the tail of epididymis at the continuation of the epididymis duct. The efferens ductus will transport sperm from the reed testes to epididymis, where they become stored. The superior expanded part that is composed of lobules formed by the coil ends are the head and the 12 to 14 efferent ductus, right, a body that consists of the convoluted ducts of the epididymis and a tail that is continuous with the ductus deferens, a duct that transports sperm from epididymis to the ejaculatory ducts from expulsion into prostatic parts of the urethra. The testes are ovoid organs suspended in the scrotum by spermatic cords. The left testis hangs more inferiorly than the right. Covered with a tough fibrous coat, the tunica albuginea produces sperm, spermatozoa, male germ cells, and hormone, principally testosterone. And the sperms are formed in the long convoluted seminiferous tubules joined by straight tubules to the red testes. On each testes is covered by visceral layer of tunica vaginalis. except where the testis attaches to epididymis and spermatic cords. The tunica vaginale closed peritoneal sac partially surrounding the testis represents the close off distal part of embryonic processus vaginalis. The testicular artery is long and slender, arise from the anterolateral aspect of the abdominal aorta, inferior to renal arteries, passing retroperitoneally in an oblique direction, crossing the ureter's inferior part of the external iliac arteries and reaching deep the inguinal rings. The testicular veins comes out from the testes and epididymis and joins to form venous networks. Papiniform plexus, which are 8 to 12 veins lying anteriorly to the ductus deferens and surrounding the testicular artery in the spermatic cord. The lymphatic drain of the testes is to the lumbar lateral aortic and preaortic lymph nodes. The autonomic nerves of the testes arise at the testicular plexus of birth on the testicular artery, which contains vaginal parasympathetic fibers and parasympathetic fibers from the T7 segments to the spinal cord. Take a look in your book, details. Of a spermatic cord and epididymis and testes. Take a look at the hydrocele testes, the hydrocele cord, the hematocele testes, which are some of the things that sometimes present in your book, right? As some extra information, you can take a look. Right. In the peritoneum and peritoneal cavity, the peritoneum is a continued glistening, transparent serous membrane lining abdominal pelvic cavity. It invests the viscerals, right? The peritoneum consists of two continuous layers, the parietal peritoneum lining the internal surface of the abdominal pelvic wall, and the visceral peritoneum invests in the visceral such as the stomach and intestines, right? In your book, take a look at the figure where how the transverse section of the abdomen looks. It says, understanding both layers of peritoneum of mesothelium, a layer of simple squamous epithelial cells, and the parietal peritoneum receives the same blood and air supply in that region of the wall of its lines. The visceral peritoneum and the organs in covers receive the same blood and air supply. The peritoneum and viscera, which are in the abdominal cavity, there are no organs in the peritoneal cavity, which empties except for a thin layer of fluid that keeps the peritoneal surfaces moist. The relationship of the viscerals to the peritoneal, it will be as follows. It says over here the intraperitoneal organs are almost completely covered with visceral peritoneum, right? Intraperitoneal A thin case does not mean inside the peritoneal cavity. Intraperitoneal organs is used to have a concept, but it's not literally invaginated into the closed sac. Right. Extraperitoneal or retroperitoneal organs are also outside the peritoneal cavity. The peritoneal cavity within the abdominal cavity continues with the pelvic cavity. The peritoneal is potentially space a capillary tenors between the parietal visceral layers of peritoneum. And it contains no organs, but contains a thin film of peritoneal fluid which lubricates the peritoneal surfaces, which allows the viscera to move over each other without friction or in allowing the movement of digestion. Lubricating surfaces of viscera, the peritoneal fluid contains leukocytes and antibodies resisting infection. Absorbed by lymphatic vessels on the inferior surface of the diaphragm, the peritoneal cavity is completely closed in males. However, there is a communication pathway in females to the exterior of the body through the uterine tubes, the uterine cavity, and vagina. This communication continues a potential pathway of infection from the exterior. Take a look in your atlas, the principal parts of the peritoneum, right? And everything that shows the greater omentum, normal position covering most of the abdominal viscera, the lesser omentum, which attaches the liver to the inner curvature of the stomach. It shows by reflecting the liver and gallbladder superior, and the greater omentum that has been removed over there from the greater curvature of the stomach to show the intestines. Right. The descriptive parts of peritoneum connects organs with other organs of the abdominal wall. The mesentery is a double layer of peritoneum, of course, a result of invagination of peritoneum by an organ and constitutes continuity of visceral and parietal peritoneum, providing means for neurovascular communication between organs and body walls. The mesentery connects the organs to the posterior wall, part of the wall. The mesentery of the small intestine, of the large intestine, is the mesocolon. The mesentery have a core of connective tissue containing blood and lymphatic vessels, nerves, lymph nodes, and fat. Right. The peritoneal ligaments. Take a look at the peritoneal ligaments and how they look, right? The falciform ligaments, the chondrohepatic ligaments, hepatoduodenal ligaments, right? The gastrophrenic ligaments, gastrocolic ligaments. Take a look in your book, the parts of the greater and lesser omentum. And the omental epiploic bursa and supracolic and infracolic compartments of the great sac. Take a look at the omental, the epiploic foramen and the omental bursa. The subdivision of peritoneal cavity, right, is over here mentioning since the fetal organs right, assume their final positions, the peritoneal cavity is subdivided into greater and lesser peritoneal sacs, right? And then for surgical incisions through the anterolateral abdominal wall, enters the greater sac, the transverse mesocolon, mesentery of the transverse colon, divides the abdominal cavity and supracolic compartment containing the stomach, the liver, and the spleen, and the infracolic compartments, which contains the small intestine and ascending and descending colon. The infracolic compartment will be found posterior to the greater omentum and will divide into right and left infracolic spaces by the mesentery of small intestine, which will make the free communication between the supracolic and infracolic compartments through the paracolic gutters, and these are also known as sulci, recessiveness, or foci. They talk about the grooves between the lateral aspects of the ascending or descending colon and the posterior lateral abdominal wall, right? The bursa slide smoothly over each other. It says inferiorly of the bursa's potential space called off, and the main part of the omental bursa posteriorly to stomach following adhesion on the posterior anterior layers of the greater omentum, and where they communicate with greater peritoneal sacs through omental foramen. And some people call them epiploid foramen, or foramen of Winslow, which is an opening situated posterior to free edge of the lesser omentum, which also is called hepatoduodenal ligament. And therefore, the omental foramen will be located through a finger along the gallbladder to the free edge of the lesser omentum, and where the omental foramen usually admits two fingers. The boundaries of the omental foramen are anteriorly portal vein, hepatic artery, and bile duct contained in the hepatoduodenal ligament. And posteriorly, the 4C and right cross of diaphragm covered with parietal peritoneum, which they are considered retroperitoneal, superiorly, and lower, which is called caudate lobe of the liver, covered with visceral peritoneum, and inferiorly, says superior or first part of the duodenum, portal veins, hepatic artery, and bile duct. Do not get confused, right? Once when you take a look at your figures, right, and when you see your tables, you will be able to see how easy it is, because everything is very well attached to quadrant spaces, right? And that's how everything is going to be found. The abdominal viscera. Take a look in your book, the abdominal viscera. The principal viscera of the abdomen our esophagus and the stomach, intestine, spleen, pancreas, liver, glandular, kidneys, and suprarenal adrenal glands. Relationship to the omenta. These organs are stunning in it. And it's asking to observe the liver, the stomach, the spleen. Right. Around the diaphragm. By the indenting thorax cavities and how it receives the protection from the lower thoracic cage, right? How the falciform ligament attaches along continuous line, anterior abdominal wall, and inferior to the umbilicus, dividing the liver into right and left parts. And the greater omentum, in its typical position, containing the intestines, the gallbladder, and the sharp borders, the inferior sharp borders of the liver. It's mentioning that the food passes through the mouth and pharynx, to the esophagus, to the stomach, mixing with gastric secretions, right, occurring in the stomach and duodenum. Peristalsis, ring-like contractions, waves, beginning around the middle of the stomach and moving slowly towards the pylorus, which is a response for mixing and masticated chewed food mass with gastric juices and for emptying the contents of the stomach into the duodenum. And the absorption of compounds which occurs in the small intestine, coil 5 to 6 meters long tube, consisting of duodenum, jejunum, ileum. Peristalsis also occurs in the jejunum and ileum. It's not just forceful unless an obstruction is present. The stomach is continuous with the duodenum, receives opening of the duct from pancreas and liver. Large intestine consists of cecum, which receives parts of the ileum, vermiform appendix, colon, ascending, transverse, descending, and sigmoid, rectum, and anal canal, which ends at the anus, reabsorbs water at the ascending colon. Feces form in the descending and sigmoid colon and accumulate in the rectum before defecation. Esophagus, stomach, intestine constitute digestive tract, derived from a primordial foregut, midgut, and hip gut. Arteria supplying digestive is from the abdominal aorta, three major branches supplying the gut, which is the celiac trunk and the superior and inferior mesenteric arteries, portal veins formed by the union of the superior mesenteric splenic vein is the main channel or portal system of veins, collecting blood from the abdominal part of GI tract, pancreas, spleen, and most of the bladder, and carries it into the liver.